Hey everybody, and welcome back to Mailbag here on your Sunday edition. My name is John Campion, and of course I am joined again by Perry Nemiroff.
How you doing, guys, Perry? Happy Sunday.
And of course, this is the Laid Back Relax Show Mailbag, where we just take your questions. Now, you can send questions to us. Make sure you use our email address. That's collidervideo@gmail.com. Fire on in your questions. We take some mailbag questions every day, Monday through Friday, on Movie Talk. And then, of course, we have our weekend show here. And I take questions from there, taking from my Facebook page, from Twitter, wherever. So let's get right into it. The first question today comes to us from Maxim Shadov, who writes, I have a question about embargoes, don't we all? Why do studios show their movie to critics before lifting the embargo? Why can't they show the movie at the time that they want critics and journalists to talk about it? For example, why show Logan on Thursday but lift the embargo only on Friday? That always bugged me that I could never understand it. Thanks for taking my question and keep up the great work. Well, thank you so much for your question, Maxim. For those of you who don't understand or know what he's talking about, when he says an embargo is basically this. A movie studio will allow online people, film reporters, film critics, whatever, to go and see the movie in advance. However, so like we went to go see Logan on Thursday. Mm-hmm. However, there was an embargo. An embargo means there is a date that you cannot talk about the movie until. In this case, the embargo was Friday at 1:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. So we saw the movie on Thursday, but there was an embargo. Sometimes we see a movie one day and there's an embargo until like 2 weeks later. So it's always different, but that's what an embargo is a set time where you as journalists or film critics or whatever cannot talk about this movie that we just let you see. And by coming to the movie and us letting you see it, you agree to not talk about it until the embargo date's left. So why would they let us see it on Thursday, but then not let us talk about it until Friday? I don't know what you think about this, but here's basically the understanding that I have. So number one, it's to make sure you don't get, as a film critic, the opportunity to put up your review before other people have a chance. So, for example, let's say they show the movie at 7 o'clock. Okay. Well, if they do Thursday 7 p.m. screenings across the country, then that means people on the East Coast, mm-hmm. outlets on the East Coast, are going to get to have their reviews up 3 hours before those here have their chance to put up their reviews. Also, it gives you a chance, it gives the film critics a chance to formulate what they want to say, write what they want to say, or put together and set shooting schedules like us when we can shoot the review. So it's a dual purpose thing. Number one, to make sure it's fair that everybody has the same working embargo date that they can release. And number two, it gives the critics and the journalists an opportunity to make sure they can get their thing together in time for embargo. You've been working with embargoes for a long time.
Too many embargoes.
A lot of different types of embargoes. How do you see this?
I do see it how you just explained it. And then there's also the mentality of, you know, for Logan in particular, perhaps they looked at the time 1:30 p.m. PST on a Friday and said, you know, that's a decent time to release the embargoes in New York when people are first getting out of work, or maybe it's lunch hour here. So that's a time where all eyes might be on computers. So that's one thing. The fairness thing I do think comes into play to a degree. Then we have the bad kind of embargo, which as a horror fan, I deal with way too often, which is they will screen something and they won't lift the review embargo until the day of. And there is no worse sign for a movie than that. A major red flag, and sometimes a red flag that is raised way too early. And the example I have for that is freaking Vampire Academy. Weinstein Company ruined that, okay, didn't ruin it, but it really killed its chances at being well received and doing well at the box office, because I don't think they promoted it as well as they could have, and also because they embargoed it. Actually, not only did they embargo it, but they also didn't screen it to the last minute, which automatically, in many minds, gives it a bad impression. Yeah, so, you know, a lot of critics never saw that movie, and the critics that did went in thinking, oh, this is going to be awful. And you know what? It's not awful. It's pretty fun. So just setting embargoes certain ways could change mentalities. And there's embargoes that come into play with set visits, too, which many people don't understand, which is completely reasonable. For example, I went to the set of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 in April 2016. However, all of my interviews ran just a couple weeks ago.
And an embargo.
And, you know, there were a lot of comments that said, well, why are you, because one of the stories that came out of it was Thanos' involvement in Avengers Infinity War, and a lot of the comments were, well, why are you running a story that was mentioned a year ago? Well, that's why, because we're not allowed to run that kind of information, and makes sense to a degree, because you don't want to spoil a movie that's a year out. At the same time, that's an embargo that I think should be changed, because imagine the hype if you're there on set a year out and you got all this great little information, because you can embargo specific information and let people talk about how excited they were to be on the set, and then, you know, that's a 1-2 punch.
And there's different types of embargoes too. For instance, a lot of times we'll go to see movies and there'll be a review embargo until like 4 days before the movie comes out. That's fine. But they'll say, but feel free to share reactions on social media.
Yeah.
So we can hop on Twitter and give our face emoji or just write on Twitter, hey, oh, I loved it or whatever. But sometimes, like Logan, they decide they didn't want the word to get out about it just yet, so they said, please don't write your review about it, and no social media reactions. So we weren't able to react on social media either. And just to piggyback on what Perry was saying, it is a massive, massive red flag for all of us here when either A, they don't screen it for the film journalists and critics until like the day before the movie comes out, or B, they have an embargo date that's like day of release. It's like, oh, so you clearly, as the studio, you don't want word to get out about your movie. And so we all just go, it's like, well, this movie's probably gonna suck because the studio doesn't have any faith in it. And that's why actually I tweeted about this when Fox had the screening for Logan like 2 weeks in advance and lifted the embargo 2 weeks in advance, I put out a tweet saying, hey guys, keep this in mind. When Fox doesn't trust their movie, i.e. Fantastic Four.
Independence Day Resurgence,
they don't show it to us very far in advance and they'll put up an embargo until like the day of release or the day before release. But Logan, they're letting us release our reviews 2 weeks in advance. That means Fox probably has confidence in the film, and for damn good reason, because that movie is awesome. All right, let's move on to the next question. The next question comes from Tech, who writes, how much do continuity and plot holes bug you when watching a movie? I know for me, it depends on how you address it. Number one, in terms of a shared cinematic universe, inconsistently continuity doesn't bother me as much. It, like Fox, for example, in their X-Men universe has continuity, schmontinuity. I mean, they'll change anything. It doesn't really matter. And that's fine because they are just focused on making this one movie the best movie it can be. And if it is in the same continuity with some errors with the other film, that's fine. So they approach that way. That doesn't bother me. Continuity issues in a movie, so it's not at least consistent with itself, that actually bothers me a lot. If something happens in the first 45 minutes, it was like, wait a minute, that guy was this and now he's that. And that'll like itch in my brain for the entire rest of the movie that I'm watching it. That'll like bother me the whole rest of the way. So within one movie, it bothers me quite a bit. What about you?
Oh, it bothers me a lot, but not like as you explained it, because that was one of my minor nitpicks of Logan, is that there's certain things within the X-Men timeline that on a first viewing for me, I couldn't connect the dots. However, the movie itself is so incredibly good and has no plot holes, so it didn't, you know, take away from my experience watching that movie whatsoever. However, I know this probably is not what this person is getting at. Another type of continuity could be a visual continuity error, and I will tell you that bothers me to no end when someone, you know, has a piece of jewelry facing one way in one scene, and then you cut back to them and it's another way. And I hate when people eat in a movie and it's like someone eating an ice cream cone or drinking a drink. Drinking a drink is the worst thing, actually. When the cup is full and then you cut back to them and it's half empty, drives me nuts.
Here's a common one that gets me, and this is usually done with an editing mistake. It's when, okay, so let's say I'm the character, right? And I'm talking, and let's say I'm talking to someone who's standing right here facing me, okay? And I'm talking to them, it's like, oh my goodness, can you believe that the soldiers ran over and took the hill? And you see me talking, and
then
the camera switches to behind my head facing the person I'm talking to, but you can clearly see that I ain't talking. So I'm like this, but you still hear the words going. Whereas if I was talking, my jaw would be moving.
Yeah.
That drives, I see that in television a lot, but it happens in some movies too.
It's either that, or when we still do see you talking, when the camera's back there, but your mouth is clearly saying something different than what is actually being heard.
Editing inconsistencies do drive me crazy. And they, again, we get kind of focused
and
obsessed
lighting
with
inconsistencies. Lighting that bothers me too.
All right, next question comes from Oda Oltelda, who writes, is there a movie that has been announced/pre-production that never happened that you wish happened. I personally would have loved a National Secret 3 movie. I loved the first two. What about you? You got any that really stand out to you that were announced, this is happening, and then it just never materialized?
I probably just ruined my one before, but it was the Final Destination one that I had mentioned yesterday. None are coming to mind right now. You go first. I'm going to think on this.
One that stands out to me quite a bit that, I mean, I thought there was some drama and it was interesting because it was a film that was going to be directed by Neil Blomkamp, who of course did District 9 and was supposed to do the new Alien. Well, he had another supposed to do movie, which was Halo. It was all announced, it was set, Peter Jackson was producing, they hired this guy that nobody had ever heard of, never directed a film in his life, called Neil Blomkamp, and he was gonna direct it, and the studios lost faith, they didn't trust the decision of hiring this guy that they had never heard of before, that had never directed anything, and the whole thing kind of fell apart after that. And a Halo movie is still, I mean, that's the video game, when you think about how popular, I mean, it's nowhere near as popular today as it was, but in its day, I don't know if any video game in history had been as popular as Halo was for that certain window of time. And the fact that we never had a Halo movie, to me, we have a Need for Speed movie, but we don't have a Halo movie. That is confusing to me, so that's the one I kind of thought they should have done.
Okay, video games put me down a track. I have two. I want to see a BioShock movie.
Did they ever announce one?
I think it's been in and out of, you know, development or someone has the rights or announces something about it because I've played a little just with friends to get familiar with it, but watching some of those trailers, it is so cinematic and so stunning. I really want to see that. And The Last of Us, I want that movie to happen so damn badly. And I don't know, maybe one day down the road, but of late, every single time we talk about that, it's just, it doesn't seem like it's moving forward anytime
Sony's
soon.
I think Sony's got some meetings going on. I think Sony wants that movie.
I hope so.
I just dropped my microphone.
It'd be a major missed opportunity if they don't adapt that story. That to me, above most other video games that come to mind, seems like the one that could be best suited for a feature film format.
All right, next question comes from Remington Keys, who writes, do you think the DCU, the Batman, will be as good of a Batman character piece as the Lego Batman movie? You know, here's the funny thing, we've talked about this before, but like one of the cool things about the Lego Batman movie, it's so delightful and fun and entertaining, but if you are somebody who knows Batman, here's the thing, when you watch the Lego Batman movie, what will stand out to you is how deep of an understanding these filmmakers have of the character of Batman. Because while it's silly and light and all that kind of stuff, if you really watch it, pay attention, you realize this is only funny and this will only work and you can only tell this kind of story, you can only have this kind of line if you really get Batman and understand to put that sort of things in. The things that they are satirizing, it only comes from a base of really knowing Batman. Now, that being said, I don't know what kind of Batman movie we're gonna get at this point, but I have to believe that in a live action that is not meant to be satirical or funny or spoofy, I do believe the new Batman movie, whenever it happens, directed by whoever's gonna direct it and starring who's ever gonna star in it, I believe it will probably be a better character piece than the Lego movie, at least on the surface, because like I said, underneath the layers of that Lego Batman movie is something pretty cool. What do you think?
I don't know. If I had answered this question prior to having seen the Lego Batman movie, I might have said, yeah, sure, they could be just as good character pieces and in different ways, but Lego Batman was so good. It
so
was
fun.
And it was like you said, it's so good on the surface for Batman fans of all generations. That's a movie where when that DVD comes out, Blu-ray, whatever you want to buy, you're going to be able to freeze frame, I imagine every single frame, and find some sort of Easter egg you missed the last 10 times you watched it. There's something for every kind of Batman fan in that movie, and it also is, it's fun, it's silly, it's light, but at the same time, there is a couple of points made about the history of Batman, and particularly the Batman's relationship with the Joker, that is surprisingly funny and poignant and meaningful at the same time. They really did an exceptional job with that movie, and until we get the Batman movie, and it doesn't meet my expectations, I'm still gonna hold out hope. So I really do hope it matches the Lego Batman movie because that is an incredible Batman movie.
All right, we're gonna move on now. And Jay Riez writes, do you think the Avengers Infinity War will be Marvel's first $2 billion movie? I am going to jump out on a limb and say no. It will not be a $2 billion movie. It will make a lot of money. It will make an obscene amount of money. It's going to be great. I have a lot of faith that it's going to be great, and it's going to make an obscene amount of money. But I do not believe it will be the next in that very rare club of $2 billion films. I don't think it's going to be that. What do you think?
Yeah, I think I'm going no on this. That's an insane amount of money. I wish I had stats here and I knew what their, do you know offhand what their highest grossing worldwide is?
The highest grossing worldwide Marvel film was the first Avengers, which was $1.5 billion.
Ah, see, you were smart and went straight to worldwide grosses, and I'm trying to navigate in a backwards way.
As of right now, there are only three films in history that are in the $1 billion, or the $2 billion club. That is Avatar, Titanic, and Star Wars The Force Awakens. Only three in history have made $2 million plus. And there are only 28 films in history that have crossed the $1 billion mark.
Looking at that list, I'm a little surprised that no Marvel movie has come closer.
Yeah,
what is that, 1.5?
Yeah, 1.5, Jurassic World made 1.6.
That's a lot of money, that's also a lot of money
off. And then it's The Force Awakens, which just crossed at $2.068 billion. So it is a super tall order. And look, when you consider that from a perceptual point of view, Captain America Civil War was basically an Avengers movie. I mean, I think it was very definitively a Captain America movie, but from a perception point of view, it's almost like an Avengers movie. And it was amazing. It's one of the greatest comic book films ever made. And it didn't even make, how much did Captain America Civil War? It made 1.1. 1.1.
That's so nuts.
It will Avengers Infinity War make double, essentially double, what Captain America Civil War did? I don't see it happening. So no, I'm gonna say no, it's not gonna happen. But you think it's got a chance?
No, I don't think it's...
Oh, that's right,
I don't think it's getting anywhere close, but I don't know. It's hard to imagine a world where one of our biggest, most popular franchises never gets into the $2 billion club with those rare few.
Only three in history ever have. It's a very exclusive club.
It's a very exclusive club. Marvel's such a special thing.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I mean, look at what's happening with superhero movies in general, or at least with Marvel movies, is that I forgot where we were looking it up, but we were assessing, maybe it was Spider-Man's potential, and I was looking at the most recent releases, and there is kind of no denying that, oh, it was comparing Spider-Man movies. That's what it was.
Right.
And it was the incredible drop-off. As much as I want to think one of the most successful franchises in film history, the MCU, will make enough to hit that mark and be in that exclusive club. At the same time, it does seem like overall, we're in a position where numbers are going to go down, given how many superhero movies are out there.
All right, next question comes to us from Elvin Rivera, who writes, why is CGI so expensive? Isn't it just hours behind a computer?
Well,
you're talking to somebody who worked in the visual effects industry for a number of years. We worked on the company I was with. I was a producer and a client services guy. And our company worked on films like terrible films. We worked on League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. We worked on Spy Kids 2.
Oh, wow.
We worked on, I can't remember the name of it now, that racing car movie with Sylvester Stallone like 20 years ago. I can't even remember the name of it, and we worked on. I take it back. We also did a little bit of work on Sin City. So there was one decent movie we worked on. But here's the thing. Think about this. The next time you go to a big visual effects heavy movie, let's, for argument's sake, say, when you're watching home video, Doctor Strange is out now. Watch the credits and watch what happens when it gets to the visual effects part. That's 3 minutes of the credits alone as thousands of names start to scroll by and like 18 different visual effects companies with tons of names, and each one of them goes by. It is huge. Mm-hmm. It is an enormous thing. And you're talking about needing a year in post-production in a lot of these movies. Thousands of people, highly talented, skilled people with expensive companies that they work for that are also trying to make profit margins, working for like a year on something like that, and then the gear you need and the machines and the what we call render farms and all this kind of crap. You look at it, it costs millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars to do little visual effects stuff. Look, well, you get one or two effects houses, you can keep it low. But for the bigger stuff, you're talking about employing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, maybe getting close to thousands of people. It's an expensive endeavor.
Oh my God, yeah. And when you think about even simple things like removing something in the background or removing something on someone's face, you think that's like taking the eraser tool in Photoshop and going like that and then it's gone. No, it's almost like animation to a degree where frame by frame needs to be addressed. And as someone moves and you have a CG effect, that you have to worry about lighting in addition to what the actual CG character or whatnot looks like. I just remember my thesis film in grad school. There were a couple of components where it had things happening on a computer screen, and it was important because a lot of the film was strictly about things that happened over the computer, like videos and stuff like that. So we needed all of our own graphics and like a live chat too. We needed all of that. And the amount of money we spent just on the computer screen visuals compared to the whole film, and it was a big production. Oh my, I still have nightmares about going through my budget and readjusting based on rates I got from VFX folks. And, you know, it was worth every penny. I mean, you just don't realize the amount of layering that goes into even making a fake YouTube video. One of the things we did is we had to make a fake newscast. And there are so many layers to that graphic to make it work. Oh, it was insane. But, you know, that's why we need more respect for our VFX folks. And we should be more aware of the incredible work that they do.
Yeah, it's funny, too. Around Clutter Video here, we had an idea for a video we wanted to do, which was going to take a little bit of animation. And very, very basic, simple animation, okay? Just very, very basic, raw kind of animation. So we called around to find out how much it would cost because it was going to be about 3 minutes long. We didn't have much money for it. It was $1,500. This was the cheapest quote we got, $1,500 a minute for like real basic little animation, like the most basic of basic of basic. It was like, it'd be $1,500 a minute. So just wrap your heads around that for a bit. All right. And you know what? Animators deserve to get paid.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Let's move on. The next question comes from Andrew Muha, who writes, do you think we'll get Bond 25 news soon? I'm a big fan of the show and keep bringing the filthy. Thanks a lot, Andrew. I'm not aware of anything. At this point, oof. I don't even think Daniel Craig is confirmed to come back again. I know he's got one more film on his deal.
Yeah.
But I don't think anybody's confirmed. There was all that nonsense going around that he wants out. It's like, no, I don't want out. But I haven't heard anybody say that he is confirmed or that he signed on or that they're going to do the next Bond with him. I think the first thing we got to hear about Bond 25 is, do we have anybody to be in Bond 25? Do we know who's going to be in Bond 25? Have you heard anything at this point?
I'm looking back now in the Collider.com archives, and the last two stories we got aren't even real news stories. They're simply Daniel Craig kind of backtracking and say that he wants to do it.
Yeah.
That by no means says he is confirmed, they are moving forward. I am a little surprised at this point that we haven't gotten an update, especially given since Daniel Craig has started starring in those movies and they've become such a huge thing.
Yeah.
You would think not even necessarily the rumor mill, but just the projects would have to start coming together. I mean, how much time are we going to have to wait between the last movie and this one? There is something to be said with not taking that much of a break, especially with something like the Bond franchise. And I have a feeling the longer they wait, the more there is a chance that Daniel Craig just might lose interest again, maybe, or might not be able to do it for whatever reason.
Yeah, the last bit of news I remember is that the producers came out and basically said, hey, make no mistake, our first choice to play Bond is still Daniel Craig. So, but that's the last thing we heard. So I think the first piece of news we need to hear is who's going to be Bond, and then we can start hearing news about that next Bond. So whether it's going to come anytime soon, I don't know. They're licking their wounds a little bit over Spectre.
He doesn't have that much coming up, actually. So even if they
he's do got time wait, in his schedule.
Even if they do wait a little bit, he's got two movies that, if IMDb is accurate, and as we know, sometimes it is not, he has two films in post-production, and the Bond 25 is listed in development, but in parentheses it does say rumored. So he doesn't seem like that busy of a guy right now. God knows what he is cooking up, though.
And if he's got two films in post-production, it means he's done. So he's just sipping margaritas right now. So. All right. Simon Blakemore writes, who had the best scene? Batman in the warehouse in Batman versus Superman when he was saving Superman's mom?
God.
Or Darth Vader in the rebel ship in Rogue One?
What kind of question is that?
Well, how would you answer that?
I wonder how I would answer it. One of my favorite scenes in all of cinema in 2016 was the Darth Vader scene that just blew my mind. I couldn't believe how good that scene was in the context of the movie. Like, forget about how it connects to what comes next. That scene was an incredibly well-shot scene. It was so tense. It was horrific. When we talked on Nightmares, one of our end-of-the-year things that we did was our favorite, you know, scary movie moments or most, you know, scariest moments in any movie period. And I chose this as my number two moment. This
was terrifying.
Oh my God, it was so well done. And the movie itself overall just serves it so well too. It's like you bring that great scene to an even greater level just because the whole movie paved the way so well. That scene.
Yeah, look, that warehouse scene was, you know, talk about this is the Logan, when we talk about Logan, this is the Wolverine we want to see. That warehouse scene to me is the Batman we've always wanted to see. I mean, that scene was amazing. Mm-hmm. I love that scene. But come on. It's the Darth Vader ripping through some fools and making their mamas cry. I mean, that's the scene. I mean, as good as Rogue One was, everybody's coming out of the theaters like, oh my God, the Darth Vader scene. I mean, that's what everybody's talking about. So yeah, I got to go with that one. All right, the next question comes from Dennis Gillum, who writes, do you think kids should not be in movies? It seems a lot of child stars grow up with issues later on in life. I think I'm going to disagree with you a little bit on that. I think, yeah, definitely there are some highlight ones, like the girl who was in Different Strokes and things like that. But I think we're just aware of those stories. We hear about those stories. There's a lot of child actors, I think, who grow up to be perfectly normal human beings. I don't think the issue is child stars. I think the issue is stars. I mean, you hear a lot about stars when suddenly now they got fame and ungodly amounts of money and do whatever, and they make stupid decisions and do stupid things. I mean, whether you're talking about a Charlie Sheen or whatever, I think there are a lot of child actors who grow up to be just fine. I think it's totally fine. It's all about the challenges they're going to face in life, and they have some different challenges. I think good parenting, you know, people who can keep them level, all that kind of stuff, and it will work out just fine. So personally, I don't think it's an issue. What do you think?
Well, fame and money make people do crazy things. There's no doubt about that. But I mean, this is the reason that in the eyes of the law, you have things like guardians who have to sign off because children can't do things like this alone. They need someone to look out for them. So I imagine largely it would come down to the parents, and sadly there's just no way to control whether you're going to be a good stage parent or not. I've worked with a lot of kid actors and they have such outstanding parents that want to foster their career yet maintain their childhood, and just they teach them such good lessons so early on that the few kids that I've worked with before have gone on to do incredible things in their career and also turn out to be really great people. So I don't think there is any kind of scenario where we could just say, okay, no more child actors should exist ever. I think it is just as easy to, actually maybe this is inaccurate, but I think it is easy to be corruptible as an adult and being in this industry and becoming successful, and it's easy to be a child. And, you know, that's why we have parental guardians and we have people that are supposed to look out for them and sign on the dotted line.
All right, the next question comes from Jack Brana, who writes, have you seen the trailers for The Lost City of Z? And if so, do you think it will be good? And do you think doing films like this outside of Spider-Man is the correct choice? Now, this is the one Sons of Anarchy.
Charlie Hunnam.
Yep. Look, when I first heard about this film, I thought it sounded amazing. I was really intrigued. I didn't like the trailer.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I didn't like the trailer. I don't think the movie looks very good at all. That doesn't mean it's not going to be good. I'll give it a chance when it comes out. But as of right now, I personally didn't think the trailer, it didn't do anything for me. It felt kind of local television cable network movie of the week a little bit to me, but maybe the next trailer will impress me more. But if you're asking me about how I felt about this trailer, not so great. Anyway, what did you think?
I think I might be thinking more so of a first trailer that came out, a shorter teaser one that was a little more atmospheric and selling the landscape of the setting of the movie, and that I kind of liked. I'm very much looking forward to this. This cast is incredible too. Charlie Hunnam, of course. I'm really looking forward to seeing Tom Holland in this, and you know, I got to give Robert Pattinson some credit. Besides Twilight, yes. anything I've seen him yes. in, he's actually
an exceptional actor. He's really good.
And so is Kristen Stewart.
What was that movie that Robert Pattinson did with Guy Pearce?
I did an interview for this.
Fact Checker Jonathan, you know that one?
Takes place in Australia?
Yes. It's like the last
something. I know what it is.
Well, Jonathan's looking that up for a second, but yeah, like, so that dude is really good,
The Rover, thank you.
He was fantastic in that.
What a unique movie, too. Yes. I mean, really, everything from where the story goes in that movie to the kind of character Robert Pattinson played really surprised me.
And let's see, we'll do our last question of the day. Actually, I'll do a couple more. Any news on Daniel Day-Lewis's next project? Mm. Daniel Day-Lewis, I still believe, I'm a huge fan of Russell Crowe. I think he's one of the finest actors on the planet. Of course, Denzel Washington, now with another Academy Award nomination, has to be considered as well. I do believe Daniel Day-Lewis, bar none, is the reigning, undefeated, undisputed greatest actor in the world. I don't think anybody comes close to him. When he, like Streep, you know, it's just a question of, hey, will she be nominated for Best Actress? The question with Daniel Day-Lewis is he going to win Best Actor? Because it feels like every other film he appears in, he wins Best Actor. It's a foregone conclusion he'll be nominated. That's for sure. That's just what he brings to it. And the dude works so infrequently. Mm-hmm. He hasn't done one since Lincoln.
He has not done one since Lincoln.
He hasn't done since Lincoln. That was what, 2012?
2012,
that came
out? Yeah.
So, no, I haven't heard anything about what his next project will be, but whatever it will, you can already mark it on your card that he will win Best Actor at the Academy Awards for.
And what it is really could be that, because his next movie is with director Paul Thomas Anderson.
And we did hear that. I totally forgot about that.
It's filming right now. The synopsis is the new movie is a drama set in the couture world of 1950s London. The story illuminates the life behind the curtain of an uncompromising dressmaker commissioned by royalty and high society. Yeah, this is a pairing that could pave the way to at least another Oscar nomination. I mean, this thing sounds good, and it's got some really solid producers behind it also. This to me looks, you know, Oscar bait is a terrible term, but this is an Oscar package right here.
This is an Oscar prestige movie. And look, I still believe to this day, I think maybe possibly Daniel Day-Lewis in There Will Be Blood, which is not the greatest movie of all time, but that might be my single favorite performance by an actor in any film ever. It's a great movie, but his performance in that is just, like, every scene is just raw, pure power and emotion and brokenness and just, this is a messed up dude. It's just so good, so good. Okay, now last question of the day, which is comes from Luke Robertson, who writes, interesting, which would you rather, Moana 2 or Zootopia 2?
Oh, that's easy.
Oh, yeah?
I think Moana functions much better as, like, that is her story, you know, that defined her. That was a coming of age story that changed everything for that character, and I think her story is told. Zootopia, however, I could very much see another Zootopia that focuses on a different character. Look at the landscape they set for that, and that's part of the reason why I'm debating between, as of right now with the animated award, I'm debating between whether I'm going to be rooting for Moana or Zootopia, because I think they are both excellent films, but they're different. They're different.
Yeah, very different films.
They come from the same company. They're both animated, but they are so different. And the world building in Zootopia, it reminds me a lot of the world building in Inside Out, and that kind of thing fascinates me. When you create a whole different playing field, and there seems to be so much more story you could tell in Zootopia.
Screw Zootopia. I enjoyed Zootopia very much. I did. I enjoyed it very, very much. But you know what? Honestly, I was just thinking about it now. I've seen it multiple times. I can't remember the name of any of the characters. I can't remember
Judy Hopps.
Okay, so there was Hopps. What was the name of the fox? And what was the name of J.K. Simmons as the lion?
Nick Wilde? Was that his name?
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
I'm probably saying the wrong thing.
I don't know. See, to me, sequel questions are about the characters. Do I want to visit with and be with those characters again? And whether you're talking about Maui or you're talking about Moana or you're talking about, you know, Haha or Hey Hey or you're talking about, you know, I just loved those characters and I love the interaction of the characters. Take me back to hang out with those characters again.
As long as a Moana sequel finally gives Pua the opportunity to shine, I can get behind a Moana sequel.
Do you know
sequel.
Pua? Pua is the pig. If you look at a lot of the advanced marketing, like,
he's
Pua
everywhere.
Is everywhere. In the original cut and version of the film, Pua was actually on, he went on the boat with Moana. It wasn't just Moana and Hey Hey. It was, Pua was there as well. Because if you look at a lot of the marketing, you'll see like the canoe with Maui and Moana and Hey Hey and Pua is there too, but they decided that, you know what, one animal thing is enough.
I'm kind of glad they did that because, you know, Hey Hey I look at as a stupid bird. Pua I might have looked at like a puppy, and I think I would have been, you know, like digging my nails into the chair if Pua was rocking on a boat and could potentially fall off.
I really enjoyed both movies, but Moana to me was a very, very, very special film, and so because of the characters again, I want to go back and hang out with those characters. All right, guys, that'll do it for this weekend's worth of mailbags. Thanks a lot for joining us. By the way, jump into the comment section below, and like, we don't just want to hear our own answers to this. How would you answer the questions that were asked today? Jump into the comment section and leave your thoughts. I want to thank, of course, Perry Nemiroff for being here. Perry, where can people find you online?
You guys can catch me at PNemiroff on Twitter and Instagram. Hope you have a good weekend.
And of course, you guys can follow me on Facebook and on Twitter, simply at John Campia. I make a lot of announcements and everything. You're going to want to make sure you're following me on my social media because I do a lot of announcements and things like that to people who follow me on social media first before we do it on Collider Video. So make sure you're following me there and make sure you subscribe to our Collider Video YouTube channel. Keep up to date on all the stuff that we've got going on. So that'll do it for us, guys. For Perry and myself, thanks for joining us and we'll see you next week.